I'm classically Abby, and this is my husband,
Jacob.
Jacob Roth. Mm-hmm. And we're going to be playing Bioshock today and talking about it and why it's, what its ideas are. Jacob, go into it a bit.
It happened to be that we were talking at the office about Bioshock a few weeks ago and about the themes in it. And so isn't that just a leftist game just criticizing capitalism? Yes, Bioshock does criticize capitalism. It criticizes objectivist hyper-libertarianism.
Insane libertarianism,
Insane libertarianism. But in that critique, even though it's from a left perspective, it actually opens the door to considering conservatism and how it rounds out things in that hyper-libertarian depiction in Bioshock, and how a lot of the problems in the society of Rapture in Bioshock have a conservative answer for how you avoid going that wrong.
Okay, so we're looking around and it says, no gods or kings, only man.
Yeah, that's a great start to society, is to elevate yourself and yourself
alone. Yeah, exactly.
One of my favorite things is just, you walk in, and this game has an amazing sense of art. You just walk in, and then Andrew Ryan's
terrifying.
Just, he's staring down at you, and you have a good sense of the art deco that's going to be beaten over your head the entire game. Just, I don't know, these moments are what made Bioshock games as art. It's just actually good art design for the
Absolutely.
Architecture that makes you want to
well,
walk
that's
slowly.
The thing. Yeah, I was going to say, that's the thing about this game that I liked when we played the first time is that it puts you in this world, and it's a world that, like, it's cool that there's an art deco world underwater. That's cool. It just happens to be a terrible society.
They have science, they have industry, they have art. What more could you possibly
want? Well, and it's funny
want?
Because it says no gods or kings, only man, and then Andrew Ryan's head is so large, he's clearly the god and the king. So.
No, totally not.
I'm sorry, that's crazy. How could I even say it?
Is a man not entitled to the sweat of his brow? No, says the man in Washington, it belongs to the poor. No, says the man in the Vatican, it belongs to God. No, says the man in Moscow, it belongs to everyone. I rejected those answers. Instead, I chose something different. I chose the impossible. I chose Rapture.
Ooh. Oh gosh, do I have to hit someone immediately? What do I do?
Yeah, you forgot.
I forgot everything, yes.
Now, you're going to see this man get gutted by this woman.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so observe his last moments. I do have to say, I do love the ads in this game.
Yeah.
If only advertisements went back to this.
I know. The thing is, it's like the style of the game is so cool.
Oh, yeah.
Well, because the 1920s is a cool era.
It's got a wonderful charm to it.
20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, all those eras are pretty cool.
Not that they're all the same.
No, very different. That's why I said them each separately.
Calm down, your genetic code is being rewritten.
Oh,
it's
my
not
gosh.
A big deal.
Everything is fine. Keep calm.
Yeah, this is what peak performance looks like. Drugs are not classic. I agree.
I said this in my channel.
What?
That drugs are not
classic? Bioshock represents the problem of drug addiction?
I did not say that. But look, now you know.
It's the core theme of this game. It's not playing God with your genetic code. It's just injecting. We're going to make our political critiques and everything like that, but that's just policy and perspective. As art, Bioshock is fantastic. It's got a lot of pathos. It really accomplishes a lot. And so just little audio things, the voice actors, all of it, it comes together extremely well. This game is very poignant. Now bash your head in with a wrench.
So Atlas is this guy who's kind of giving us guidance about where we need to go, and he told us that his family has been taken
by the dictator of the city, the industrialist Andrew Ryan with the giant statue of his own head. A thing in this game is you have your underwater society made to be some hyper-libertarian utopia. They happen to discover this material underwater and these sea slugs that let you rewrite the genetic code of people. Naturally, of course, it becomes superpowers, but...
Should I save? It told me to save.
Yeah, sure, save.
Okay.
So people use this material to rewrite the genetic code. It gives them all kinds of abilities. A thing that's going to come up in the game in like the first section is there's a plastic surgeon you have to fight who would use it to like completely reshape people. And he was inspired by Picasso, so the reshaping he did of people was cubist. and unfortunate, but it had an effect on people of making them go mad, and basically was responsible for the city's downfall. But the artistic premise of the game is, yeah, the genetic rewriting drove people crazy and destroyed the city, but really it was the inherent degenerate philosophy of the city that made something like this inevitable, even without the superpowers. So as I was explaining before, you have the billionaire industrialist who ran the city, and so, there you go. So he's based on Walt Disney, Howard Hughes, those classic billionaires, and he wanted to create this hyper-libertarian utopia so that men with his ambitions could avoid being constrained by communism or American welfareism or religiosity, anything like that, you know, self-actualization to the most self-regarding, selfish degree. And so he is the one who, in the chaos of the city, ended up using a pheromone system that affects the people who splice up with that atom stuff so he can make a private army. And so that's who's opposing this. He's the Chechnya vodka. There we go.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, you know, you're trying to deal with having killed 10 people or whatever.
The cold shower clearly didn't do enough.
Cold shower followed by 12 bottles of Chechnya vodka is the winning move. Oh, he does have a beautiful signature in blood.
Well,
gotta
I was
going to
say,
credit.
I don't believe him. But above all, do no harm.
He just defines harm through an alternative metric.
Ah.
In this society, they overlap with the woke. They say that, you know, everyone can have their own kind of cultural performance of standards.
Right.
It's oppressive for you to say that you know what harm is in advance. It applies to everyone.
Fair. There
and clearly, you go. Whatever happened here is just a beautiful and unique expression of what not doing harm looks like.
There you go. It all makes sense now.
You know what?
Don't get more vodka.
You're right.
Potato chips. You know what? At least he's not wandering around double vision situation.
Yeah, no. Now he's just fat and unhappy with himself. Oh, good. More potato chips. You can get them for free in this place, apparently. Oh, wait. Trophy. Can we do anything with this trophy?
You can carry it around and show that you're a winner.
It's probably a participation trophy.
If Bioshock wasn't about a terrible society, I think this would be a cool place to visit. And I'm sad that something like this doesn't exist. And, like, a good version of it. Like, a vacation spot, as opposed to this. People are saying that Daft Punk broke up today.
Oh, I'd seen about that.
I don't know anything about Daft Punk.
You're good. No. Didn't they do One More Time? Or am I just showing complete cultural ignorance?
Please check the chat
to see if I'm
correct.
Yeah, no, you know what?
Chat, tell us about Daft Punk.
It's
we
like
don't
Who
know.
Wants to Be a Millionaire? You let the audience correct you because you know they're right.
One.
I just saw someone say that Daft Punk did do One More Time, so...
Oh, did they? Oh, yes, they did One More Time.
This mattered. This mattered so much. Aesthetics are a moral imperative.
So that's a statement.
Yeah, so I will say this is actually a handy little reference point for just... Idolatry comes in many forms, and we associate paganism with the ancient world. Paganism, idolatry, are anything that is finite that you put in the seat of the infinite. If you let something as cramped and limited as a thing that you like or that could have some value, and you mistake that for all that there is to value, you will sacrifice far too much for the sake of something that's far too small.
Well, and it's often said that the idea that there's been civilizations that were beautiful and valued beauty in different things, so beauty is not moral.
It's not sufficient. It is nourishing. It is a vehicle to get across that which is maybe more abstract and appealing, like real moral messages. Couching it in proper aesthetics makes it better. It's like having vitamins or medicine that you put good flavoring on.
Right.
It's going to get people to encourage you to do the right things, but the good flavoring itself is not the medicine.
Right, exactly.
So the way that the left can put a message into a video game, you know, to think of something unique, it'll take me a moment. But broadly, it's the same way that you can put it into anything. which is that you frame the facts of a narrative. For example, you make a game about Vietnam. What are you going to do? You're going to have the obligatory, like, war crime sequence or something like that for the U.S. Or you won't focus on why the North was fighting the South. You're going to just make it seem like a generic conflict that the U.S. also did a war crime. Just anything like that. A really big problem when it comes to artistic representations of historical events is what the audience will assume to be neutral that is actually politicized. So as I was saying with Vietnam, you know, oh, well, everyone just knows that X thing is historically what happened. Well, how do you know that? The way we talk about current events now and the way we frame anything is always politically charged. You look at something like the Iraq War. There's no neutral narrative about deciding to go to Iraq or what went down there or the justifications for doing it. All of that is a series of debates to be had about people's motives and about what all that means.
Right.
Well, so you go back to any historical epoch,
I mean, and it's
they'll get away with treating their own narrative as just the established fact that we all know. So that's a really big thing. You see it in movies,
right.
Games can accomplish the same thing.
You see that in movies. I talked about that with The Crown. It's very easy to see it in historical films because they're not, there's obviously a narrative and they're obviously trying to get across their viewpoint. And it's even easier to see it when you can consult history and say, okay, did that really happen?
We had a flashback to that amazing cigarette we had at the beginning of the game.
Oh my goodness.
I am going the wrong way though. Whoops. There we go.
But yeah, so it's easy to actually confirm biases because you can look at the history and say, okay, well, they're not giving us the whole story. And that's true in video games and it's true in movies.
Yeah. Okay, we have a moment here. This is the introduction of the morality system in the game, which is extremely binary. Basically, you have these little girls, as we were describing, and you can rescue them.
This is such a moving thing, in my opinion.
Yes, but before
yeah,
we go
I'll
on,
go.
I'll set up a little background for it.
Yeah.
So we describe the society underwater, hyper-capitalist, no gods, no kings, no masters. Great. They discover this genetic rewrite material, gives them superpowers, rots your brain, and then apparently makes you susceptible to being pheromone chemical brainwashed. Great. But the thing is that with the collapse of the society and everything else, they don't have enough of this atom material to go around and keep people stable and keep this little ecosystem functioning. So apparently these little girls were able to be genetically modified so that they could harvest the atom from corpses, reprocess it, and then put it back into circulation, which makes them a big target for these Spicer mutant people who, if they can get a hold of them, can extract tremendous amounts of the atom to keep themselves going. So we, as the player character, to become stronger, need this atom stuff to rewrite ourselves, add the superpowers. And so when we come across these little sisters, as they are called, you have the morality choice. Rescue them, gives you less of the atom, or harvest them, gives you more. Also, it makes you a very mean and terrible person. And the game has two endings, a mean and terrible one, which is if you harvest them, and a nice and fuzzy, genuinely heartwarming one if you rescue them.
Everyone's saying to harvest, we will not harvest.
Yeah, no.
We're not gonna do
yeah,
that.
Yeah, no.
So, sorry about that.
No. There we go.
No. No. No.
I like the little music sting.
I do too. And it's much better in the first game, I think.
Yeah. Thank you,
and
mister.
And she's much cuter in the first game.
Thank you for helping me.
So,
we look like wee little girls.
I don't get so. There's a whole thing with Atlas and there's a twist in this game. He's not necessarily the nicest guy. But the whole pitch that the little sisters aren't little girls anymore, I don't even get how that's possible.
We literally just saved her and she was a little girl.
Well, even before then. Okay, she looks like a mutant. She looks like a slug person. Granted, she has like a reverb voice that sounds like a
right.
demon in a movie that's possessing some of Little Echo.
Right.
Granted. And they're brainwashed to try and stab corpses with syringes
yes.
to harvest and reprocess
yes.
their blood. Granted. But everything they do is very little girl-esque and
it's
they're
true.
Just like brainwashed.
It's true.
There's like a plot point in the game about once they're saved, they still, like, go through the motions and have a draw to, like, try and do the atom stuff, because that was just, like, mental programming.
Right.
So, with the addition of superpowers, they are not any less little girl or human.
Right.
They're just little girl plus in an unfortunate manner.
Yeah, no.
You're getting props in the chat for being pro-life.
Of course. Hello.
Yeah, see, that's how we know that we have degenerate leftists in the chat telling us to harvest the little sisters. Consume the child.
No.
Nah.
We're not going to do that.
Besides, they gift us a teddy bear with goodies, so it's not even an advantage. Yeah, you know what? I think this
the
society
ending.
Is getting to me. The only way my morality goes down in this game is utterly transactional. Uh-oh.
I'm sure.
Oh, it's having an influence. Yes, you do get more Adam when you harvest the little sisters. But really, what is the purpose of the game? Just to get better at fighting? No, it's for the moral achievement of the happy
yes!
ending. But unironically.
But absolutely, I play video games for the story. I do not play video games for the fighting, which is why I don't mind if Jacob plays the game and I just watch, because
yeah.
I like listening. But I'm not, you know, tonight we're going for it. So I'm playing. This is dark for anyone. Just
oh yeah, out. That is a crucified smuggler who was smuggling Bibles, as if that were not on the nose. We made it to the second chapter of the game, second level. Thematically, this level is actually kind of about how outside influence infiltrated this hermetically sealed society, I guess literally and figuratively, at the bottom of the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
And so this might be
a good
pausing point for the next time.
Yeah.
And to be terrible, the story of how we met also...
Fine.
For next
we'll
time.
We'll save it for next
because
time.
Because
in
its full
also
bloom, it deserves at least 5 minutes.
I know, it does take... It takes a good amount of time to talk about. It's something I've been wanting to put on my channel for a while. So
we'll
we
do
might
a first
do...
Draft
yeah, I was gonna say,
live.
We'll do, this is
we'll
the first draft on here.
Everyone.
Yeah.
You'll find out.
Yeah, you can watch it here, and then you can watch it on my channel again with even more detail.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
So, one last thing of among the commentaries. So... First chapter was about introducing you to the world of Rapture and Steinman and that whole narrative of like the aesthetics and kind of like an Icarus thing, you know, Icarus flew too close to the sun, melted his wings, fell down. This society with Adam can remake man in any form physically, and that power without any limits led to just a complete degeneration. You know, Babel style, you also go up so high you end up destroying yourself. So you see how people get turned into physical, grotesque monsters because there's nothing grounding them and no paying attention to like a human nature of any kind. Here in the second chapter, we have the religious themes in the society, and then also in terms of narrative about how this hermetically sealed society had smuggling and outside influences kind of be the progenitor for organized crime in the society, which led to people trying to rival Andrew Ryan as the great dictator of the city, who also wanted to be like an anarchist, libertarian, capitalist utopia. So there's a lot of layered things here, which makes it really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
But I will point out, we have here the Great Chain, and the Great Chain is this metaphorical thing in the philosophy of Andrew Ryan about the great chain of commerce and cooperation.
Right.
It's his adaptation and then pagan idolization of a degenerated version of the invisible hand. Yeah, the invisible hand, the idea that people pursuing their normal run of just business and things to make a living for themselves drives them to act in a pro-social way, which makes sense in the context in which it was originally set. You take anything, remove all limits and normal, just pragmatic grounding, and you make it your god, you're gonna get the Great Chain in an explicitly atheist society. You still have a god, you still have religious art, and you still have things that lead people completely astray. There's a great quote that I love from David Foster Wallace, which is, there's no such thing really as an atheist. You don't get a choice about believing. You're going to believe. You just get a choice about what you believe. So this section of the game is a really good kind of presentation of that theme.
Okay, well that was our first part of playing through Bioshock. Thanks for hanging out with us while we did it. My Jacob was, you know, doing better than I was. But, you know, I got some things. I did some of it. I ran into some walls. That wasn't the best part.
You ran into some walls, which were your obstacle to overcome.
They were.
And yes. you discovered how to think laterally. Step to the side of the wall and then move forward. Thank you all for viewing. Thank you for participating
for
in the chat.
Us.
And
we'll see
there were some great
time.
Questions this time. And we look forward to more discussion of the game, our lives, conservatism in general. Just
keep asking questions
yeah.
in the chat, because we like being able to communicate with you guys. So. Yeah.
It was a lot of fun. Thank
cool.
y'all.
Thanks,
have a great
guys.
Night.